Hallo.
Hallo.
Lauda.
Hallo.
Hallo.
Immer wieder sehr schön hier.
It's herzukommen. Always nice to come back here. Like a family.
Stiefvater, der fragt
with the stepfather who asks you why you haven't finished your studies yet. The pressure is very high for me as well. I would like to start, though, with something that's very important to me and to you as well, I hope. It has to do with everything. I want to start with this.
Friday is the hashtag for demand and freedom. What did is UTL, the Turkish-German journalist who is in Turkey.
Euren eher höflich als engagiert klingenden Applaus.
I forgive your polite rather than enthusiastic applause, and I would like to add that this is not just for Dennis Yücel, but also for all others who are in prison for their investigative work. Today is an important day on several levels. Something personal first, perhaps. This is my 10th anniversary on Twitter. To the day. It sounds strange today, but back in the day I thought I was one of the very last people to join Twitter. So I know how it feels to come late to a party, and if you look, then you can see that my first tweet only got 20 likes and 5 retweets. So I know how you feel.
But
I'm not going to be insulting anyone. Today is a special day on several levels because today is the day of the liberation.
The day that Germany finally capitulated in the Second World War in 1945.
And I think it ought to be a public holiday. I read that Bavaria has about 47 public holidays per year and Berlin and Hamburg only 3. But this is one of those that Bavaria should have as well.
Aber ich möchte das als Steilvorlage benutzen, den Tag der Befreiung, der 8. Mai.
I want to use this
1945,
this day of the 8th of May 1945 to speak about recapitulation.
Previously on Earth, würde man vielleicht sagen.
What happened previously? Previously on Earth, you might say. The first disturbing thing since my last talk to the state of the talk about the state of the nation. The first disturbing thing for the world has to be that we are now living in a time
mit nichts als der Qualifikation
where nothing well, the only thing that needs to qualify you to become US president is your haircut, and you may find this stranger than I do. We also live in a time, to be very precise, where we're finding out
Brexit mit Anlauf
thanks to Brexit that you can shoot yourself in the foot with a head start,
man sich offenbar freuen muss, wenn nur
which was thought to be anatomically impossible previously, and we have to be happy that only 33% or as in France or 49% of Austrians vote for a right-wing party. Most of you either nerds or would like to be nerds because it's become hip. You can imagine it as if 67% of the Wi-Fi password were known. That's where we're at from my perspective, and that's my very own perspective. I'm just like you, but I'm more open about the fact that I'm egocentric and just keep posting selfies on the internet. I feel something that's not very nice. It's a It's a tremor, if you will. Something has changed, and this change did something to me.
Seit ungefähr Ende 2014 mit diesem Prozess.
Ever since 2014, I've thought about this process, mainly because that's when the right-wing Pegida movement that happened both online and offline was established. And in the height of this, at the pinnacle of this movement, there was a Facebook page that had 160,000 likes, and they got up more than 10,000 people on the streets to protest. And
in den sozialen Medien, vor allem in den
they had similar things going on internationally. And ever since the end of 2014, I've been watching these movements. And it's not a secret that I've been spending time in some corners on the internet that aren't the most polite in the world.
Aber es hat sich auch was verändert, weg von
but something also changed away from trolling towards something that I would like to describe as hate speech. I'm going to quote an email that I got in that context in the summer of 2015 about an article on Spiegel Online that I wrote, where I wrote that I don't think that it's right to shoot migrant boats on the Mediterranean. I thought that would be something that many people would be able to agree on, but apparently I was wrong. This is what the email looked like. Thank you for the article. There is no better proof that we need
man vergasen, eigentlich noch viel zu human, aber man ist ja kein
to
Unmensch.
Be able to exterminate people like you.
Und der restliche Menschenmüll bei Spon fällig bist.
But I'm hopeful that there's not long before also people like you are going to be exterminated. Watch out, you freak, the wind is turning. That's a brief summary.
Empfinde mich nicht, auch wenn das vielleicht komisch ist, als Opfer.
I don't feel like a victim, and that may sound strange. No, on the contrary, I have quite a few privileges. One of them is the fact that I've been confronted with hate online for more than 10 years. It started with trolling and insults. Then there were people who were standing in front of my house, some of them drunk. But I know how to deal with these people. I've training, if you would. But something's different here, not just the force of the insults, but also that you can only try to understand what's behind this. And I'm not a victim. There are people who have it far worse than me and who don't have the training that I have. But it's very significant that this hate speech seems to be coming from a group, a social group that thinks that it is becoming more important, the wind is turning, there are enough people, that's what they're writing. And this tremor has intensified last year. I started dealing with this in 2015. The tremor has intensified from Pegida and the right-wing AfD party towards Austria, Brexit, Trump, Erdogan.
Und immer ist ein bisschen mehr Erschütterung dazugekommen. Immer ist auch ein bisschen mehr Ermüdung dazugekommen.
Got stronger and stronger each time, and it got more tiring each time. What interested me a lot in this context, in the context of these last four, Austria, Brexit, Trump, and Erdogan, is that the share during the elections looked like this. It was, well, slightly idealized. It was always a 51-49 split. I always took the measures I liked. But at the first glance, you might assume that this is a maximal polarization, and that might not even be wrong.
Und Frankreich, die man seit gestern
so, and the question, and what about France, that we can answer since yesterday? why only a third in France? The New York Times found an answer to this earlier today. And the answer is, there is no Fox News in France. At least partly. Another part of the explanation is that
von Macron
geleakt
worden ist, dass da einfach schon eine
Macron's documents were leaked at a point where there was already a news embargo around the election.
Mal Herrn Assange zu beobachten.
And that makes it interesting to watch Mr. Assange and the associations, the acquaintances he has. I had a look at when the leaks around the Clinton email started, which was exactly half an hour after Trump's grab them by the pussy remark.
Wir haben jetzt also eine Situation, die ich mal ein bisschen zusammenfassen
möchte. So now we have a situation that I would like to summarize thus. The New York Times says there is no Fox News in France and therefore those leaks were unable to decide the vote. But it is interesting whether or not you share that opinion.
Dass überall dort, wo traditionelle Medien mit einstimmen in so eine
all those places where media tends to join in this
offenbar diese ziemlich
this tabloid mentality that there is that goes hand in hand with this polarization.
Die sozialen Medien für alle möglichen Entwicklungen mitverantwortlich.
I'd like to assign part of the blame to social media. That's what I do all the time. But we mustn't lose focus on those on the traditional sensationalist media who like to join in this chorus.
And it's exactly because of that I believe that what I'm trying here is an instrumentalization of social media in a positive sense. My talk is about from speaking in social networks, serving suggestions for strengthening liberal democracy with the help of social media.
Aber zunächst mal eine Beschreibung von dem, was ich so gemacht habe.
To describe what I've actually done in the last year. The last year throughout I was extremely busy.
Bis in die Details.
I was into the detail involved with things, had to take care of things. And at the same time, as I just said in the introduction, I did try to not leave the debate out of my sight. I have to also say in advance that there is a certain personal positioning here to be made, a positioning that in the 20th century would have been called absurd, but today everyone who is in the public eye, public focus, is really obliged to say this. This positioning, therefore, is that I consider myself a left liberal democratic constitutional patriot, European, and a globalization and digitalization profiteer. And I am trying to work for digital and social enlightenment. So everything I'm going to say, the whole analysis, is to be seen under this angle. If you ask what is a constitutional patriot supposed to be, I would respond, well, we are in a country where our grandparents and great-grandparents murdered millions of people, so you have to respond and position yourself in some way to this. And so you don't want to be too happily patriotic. And therefore, I use this concept of constitutional patriotism, where I'm proud of the Constitution and the basic principles that are enshrined in it. And every time I cheer for our national team, I do think about the Constitution partly as well. I admit that this is a very, well, far-reaching and very, very constructed thing to say, but that's my speciality. All those years in the Internet, I saw millions of endeavors pass me by, but only in the last few years, or even perhaps particularly since 2016, I could really understand what all these quotes, one of the all these quotes meant, the Churchill quote that said, democracy is the worst of all government forms, with the exception of all the others that we've tried. So Churchill, this great Twitterer before Twitter, this quote, you could see a lot next to Benjamin Franklin images, for example. And you can see this pass by and say, well, it's a funny quote, and everyone has something clever and something stupid to say, and some of these things are preserved and some aren't. But what this actually means can be found in the headline that I had here, the pain of democracy. And the pains of democracy manifested for me in what I've mentioned before, that tremor. And for this tremor, a woman found a perfect small sentence that fantastically summarizes that tremor. It's Anja Meyer, who works for Taz, the German left paper Tageszeitung, who in 2013 already, in the refugee context, and Facebook, because she was working in a village in Brandenburg in the provinces, she wrote, I thought we had progressed further. I believe that it's important to admit your own shock. I really thought we had progressed further. We went to Facebook and saw things that I never thought people would just dare to publish. This shock didn't quite hit me as strongly, I thought, at first, as this kind of social impression, but The more I looked inside, the more I realized that this tremor and shock was shared by some people in my left liberal democratic media purple circuit and all the internet people that knew everything in advance the way it was going to be afterwards. But I still noticed that this tremor said something about myself. So I went to an analysis of that tremor or shock and said, okay, Trump, yeah, you may find this not good, that's completely correct, and it is not good, but what is my own part in that shock? Where perhaps I seem to have gone a bit too far, and I held back and I noticed that I had to admit something about my own political discourse in the last few years, because I had, in my own positioning in the last years, I was self-affirming too much in all or almost all or at least many of the things I shouted out into the world. I didn't explain my position to the world, but also to myself. And I often tried to convince myself that it's really right by finding particularly hard and clear words. And that is not necessarily the way to make friends on the internet, particularly with debates that are a bit more delicate. This is an admission that not my political position was disturbed by that, but the way I dealt with these political positions. And this is one of the first things I want to point to. And then I found something else, noticed something else about me. I want to conduct a very thorough self-inspection here. I think that in a democracy, even difficult and even completely stupid opinions have to be tolerated, at least as far as they are not real hate speech. And I also believe that the borderline to hate is not easy. Can you say this is hate, or is it just very stupid? I've become less tolerant in this, because stupid would only mean stupid in my own coordinate system. It would not necessarily be the same for other people. It might even be smart for other people. And I noticed I got angry much quicker, and I asked myself, why am I more angry and less tolerant? I believe that this is an effect of social media. Social media as a completely mined territory. Because I think with all those opinions that you confront, that you're confronted with on social media, you tend to lose patience with the hail of opinions, because other people have this unpalatable property of having different opinions. You know this phenomenon. And that has a back effect on myself. There's this anger, this becoming furious. And that, of course, has an influence on my own work. The work for digital society and its enlightenment. So if my approach of improving the world, if I look at that, I have to adjust it. My work for the enlightenment of the digital society has to be measured along its effects, and not just about myself. That would be a bit delusional, but also what I say, and I keep saying things with hard and clear words. It didn't quite work so well in other countries either. So, because I had copied my approach to some extent from the US, and if the effect of my world improvement methods, the enlightenment, if that doesn't work in the way I wanted, hopeful, then I use the very simple conclusion, change a losing team, and I'm trying to further the effect of my improvement methods. And it's about the effect, not the objective. I'm not changing the objective and saying I'm going to become a Nazi, although with my hairstyle you may, well, that's a different thing.
So it's about developing your method, but for that I have to start with an analysis of the problem. What is going wrong? What's going wrong in society? In January of 2016, I started conducting a private heuristic, which is a term that sounds a bit smarter than, yeah, I try to feel and to guess and to read things. How did I do this? For about 1 year, I dived into debates on Facebook, on blogs, in chats with about 100 people that I felt were on the right or extreme right part of this political spectrum, and as well as 20 people from my circle of friends who had begun doubting democracy, and I started engaging them in discussion. And this did not remain unnoticed. I had to operate a bit more clandestinely. The Süddeutsche Zeitung newspaper wrote an article about this simply because they saw that I didn't just shout back in an argument, but I actually tried to understand their position. But I also watched the Facebook group Ich bin hier, I am here, whose conduct I think is exemplary, because you can see they show which style of argument works and which doesn't. An important point in this is the wording on one slide where you may have raised your eyebrows but didn't cough strongly enough, because I said that I engaged 100 people in discussion who I think are on the right end of the spectrum, but this is very subjective, right? But I agree that it is subjective, but I started saying not only right-wing, but also right-wing extremist, so that everybody will know the part, they can find out for themselves where they are on that spectrum. And I found out some interesting things. And the first thing is that there are not just right-wing and right-wing extremists, but also people who are simply not sufficiently immune to the right end of the spectrum. I borrowed this term. I don't know how it's properly defined. But there are people who say, yeah, okay, there's someone who thinks that we should murder all Syrian refugees when they show up at the border. And I think that's wrong, but I'm still going to go to a protest with them. So people who have a hard time differentiating themselves to the right end of the spectrum. Okay, so that was definitely the least enthusiastic applause of the evening. So these people who I think are right-wing, and I used to like to call them Nazis, but I started engaging them in discussion and tried to understand their point of view in a bit more detail. This, of course, included some very obvious Nazis and then people like right-wing extremists. But when I started engaging them, when I started to ask them why they wanted to murder people, I started to understand that this line I've been trying to draw might not be correct, but that a part of them might simply be trolls and assholes or temporary assholes. It seems to have happened a lot to me that I called people Nazis who were just assholes. It might not be easy to understand, but because it's obvious.
Manchmal die Einschätzung, die man hat, getrieben ist von genau
that dem Moment, in dem man your understanding is sometimes driven by the area in which you're surrounding yourself, and this may lead to wrong conclusions, and we are going to see that later. So in addition to these right-wing extremists and trolls and assholes who thought they were being funny, we also have people who are angry, people who are very angry, and people who are very, very angry.
Leute, also wenn man die direkt angesprochen hat,
people who simply were not, who you simply could no longer reason with. And I think it's important to differentiate there, because I know that when I myself am angry, I say things about cats that I don't really mean.
Ebenfalls habe ich von mir als rechts oder rechtsextrem empfundene Person kennengelernt.
And I got to know some people who are scared or concerned with simply the wrong friends. People told me on Facebook when I chatted with them that they simply said things because their friends liked it when they said those things.
Die ich als rechts empfunden habe, mit einem Mal zwischendurch auch ganz normale Konservative waren, wo ich mich einfach in der Einschätzung so ein bisschen.
I must also tell you that there were some people whom I simply estimated wrongly, who were simply conservative, but not right-wing extremists, not right-wingers.
Sind so subjektiv, dass man sie eigentlich als
and these
auch mit der Auslehnung der einzelnen Worte
the sizes of the of the slices in this pie chart are very subjective. There's partly to do with the length of the words. It's purely symbolic. But there were also combinations. People who used to were very, very angry a moment ago, when I would have thought, oh, that's an obvious Nazi. But a moment later, they agreed that, yeah, that might have been a bit harsh to wish all of them dead. But these conservatives really did exist. And finally, the second group to last were the people who are simply disturbed. I don't want to call them crazy, because that's not a term I want to use. But people who were very obviously irritated or disturbed. And then lastly, there were simply people where I have no clue what the hell they were thinking. People who I thought were right-wing extremists and then turned out to be great colleagues that you can take out for a beer and then talk about the Holocaust. No, that's not what happened. They're people who turned out to be to have actually multifaceted viewpoints and ended up showing things that I was actually able to appreciate as reasonable, even if I did not agree with their opinions. And I tried to understand these people, and this may
und zwar etwas stärker als ich gehofft hatte. Nochmal ganz genau gesagt, dass ich häufig Leute für Nazis gehalten habe, die eigentlich nur genau in diesem Moment Arsche waren. Und ich war auch schon
often thought people were Nazis who were simply assholes, and I'm an asshole sometimes as well.
Es soll aber schon die Erklärung dafür oder zumindest eine Erklärung anbieten.
Is trying to explain this behavior, and unfortunately, I've become more afraid. But I at least know how to cope with this, and I hope to find some way to fight against this.
Sorry, it's not about the explanation. Is not just about what the fuck is wrong, but how the fuck is what the fuck wrong. Uproar. And as an explanation, I found a metaphor that initially I found completely convincing, but the more I used it, I found it more and more confusing, and in the end I thought it was complete catastrophe and wouldn't use it. And then again I thought, well, okay, yeah, still, I'm going to use it. Because I was thinking at some point that the political level of liberal democracy, that is an island, the island of liberal democracy on which we are, in which we stand with our attitudes and opinions, the island simile, and that island is swimming in a brownish liquid. It's not shit, but this is the sea of the authoritarian, which perhaps is shit after all. And this island of liberal democracy and the sea of the authoritarian around it, that is somewhat related to that tremor I felt, where I thought, whoa, what is happening out there? So many people that in cases of doubt should have a certain amount of reason. But then I had to find that from my perspective, this is not sustainable, but not because these people were not reasonable, but because they were reasonable in a different way to myself, or perhaps not at all. In some cases, the island of liberal democracy, you could regard like having political opinion A on one side and B on the other. I used the black and red flags for that. This is random political opposing parties or camps, and the thinking with the social perception and progress that we had, there should be a certain progress in social society as well. For me, it was too slow, and I imagine that it was too slow for you as well, but quite obviously that doesn't apply to everyone. What is acceptable as a society for a society has bit by bit shifted into the liberal sphere and tends to be in the left liberal sphere. We may not see it this way, but that's what we fought for, and we fought for change, positive change. But in fact, there were mechanisms involved that didn't take everyone with them. This is a tweet from 2016, trying to make a joke that doesn't offend anyone in 2016.
And if you just
think about what this means about the last 20 years, you find that as late as 1997, you could vote against rape being made a crime within a marriage, as you can see from people like German politicians, including, surprise, the very conservative Erika Steinbach. That is 20 years ago, a position that these days you would consider at least right-wing radical, and even people that you would consider somewhat liberal abstain, such as even Guido Westerwelle and these others. An issue about which you cannot really have a divided opinion these days, but back then, opinion was divided. There was a certain uproar, of course, and insults were traded, but this was a position that found itself reflected in Parliament. And at the same time, this is not just in Parliament, but also within the people out there. Here you can see the response when Peter made a sexist joke in 1987. And here you see the same situation. Peter tells a sexist joke in 2017, and he gets this almighty kick, I don't know what it's called, with a burning foot. Now, what is conspicuous here is the friend. I use the word friend circle in the English spelling here, because this is related to social media. The private and the public spheres mix, and the what you feel to be the digital living room suddenly is underlying the rules of the big public. Suddenly you will be hit in the face for something that you said 30 years ago in the pub. You say in the digital pub now, and the sister of your work colleague sees this on Facebook and says, "Are you crazy?" and so on, and reports it to the employer and so on. So there is a lot of symbolism involved here, and exactly in those places where you said something, say a mildly sexist person, suddenly getting sanctioned in a public sphere. You see, this person seems to get crucified for this, but I said something myself. I have to delete this immediately. And don't misunderstand me. I am part of this sanctioning. I am involved in it too, and I don't think it's completely wrong. I think it's right to tell people that if they make sexist or anti-Semitic, if they post dirt of that ilk, to tell them. But the way this happens does lead to some people saying, "I was able to say this earlier, and now I can't anymore without getting hit in the face." So there is a change in people's minds, and I think that is part of the problem. And another part of that problem is that this brown liquid in this around this island of democracy keeps rising gently through a very complicated chain of events that I didn't dare to analyze until the end. And while this brown liquid keeps rising and social progress is being driven forward, the room on the island is getting more and more scarce. You realize that you have to pull together. If you compare to 20 years ago, when a member of the Bavarian Conservatives, or well, the German Conservative CDU, could vote against making rape in marriage a crime, these days you couldn't do that anymore, so it seems a bit tighter. And I, at the same time, find this very good, but also bad in some aspects. Because I believe that the people that didn't quite make it along the way with our social development, that these people suddenly, because they didn't take part in the pulling in, they are partly in that brown liquid and wondering why they're getting their feet wet, and people point towards them, point their finger at them and say, well, he's over the line, he's wet. And I believe that we have to fight for this island, therefore. And that's not just my opinion, but also that of Mr. Habermas, Jürgen Habermas, who calls for a democratic polarization, because he says we need a larger island again. So opinions that are far apart but still compatible with the basic rights in the Constitution. So there is not just a polarization of 51-49 that I was talking about earlier, the wrong kind of polarization, but it seems that there is also a right kind of polarization. And how do you fight about that, for it, by going to the marginal areas, those the things that sound kind of yucky but still are okay. So we're fighting at the margins. And for this fight, I have a kind of, well, a small communication theory that I came up with, banal communication theory. I'm not a scientist, I'm just an observer of phenomena. So the communication scientists, I asked them to form a proper theory out of my Orwell kind of theory. But when I looked at this communication, I noticed that in contrast to earlier communication, social media happens on stage all the time. You're not debating in a usual way. There's always an audience around. And there has to be an audience. And that audience can be global, of course. So you talk, if you notice this, and everyone does, you talk not just with the person in front of you, but also with that invisible third person, those friends. Everything I say is not just directed at the person in front of me, but also to some extent at your friends. And that leads to that self-affirmation. And everyone that's ever responded to a strange or dumb comment has no other target, no other objective, but to get a few likes from their friends. And that is the opposite of the discourse that I really wanted. And that is actually being researched on intensely these days. Someone in Nature published third-party punishment as a costly signal of trustworthiness, which is meant to say that the essence is that it seems to be the case that towards your own groups you appear particularly trustworthy when you invest a lot of time to fight those and condemn those that behave badly. The second point about social media in my Orwell theory is the hyper-emotionalization. Because social media, they call it engagement, but they lead to emotions. And this hyper-emotion can be exhausting to individuals. This rhythm that you hear about so much, it does lead to things being pulled to the front that are the most emotional things, and that has an exhausting effect on me too, particularly on me. And in heterogeneous groups, it can lead to dissent. And these feelings in a social context can lead to people starting to be trolls. We've seen that troll element, temporary assholes, and it does seem to be the case that out of a bad mood you can start to troll, kind of shoot against what you don't like, and when the discourse seems to be getting out of hand from your point of view, you tend to lose it, then trolling can be the countermeasure. And finally, As the third part of this OL communication theory,
Empörungsstürme können ja sogar richtig ein Abwehrsystem sein. Ich lehne diesen Begriff Shitstorm tendenziell ab.
Hyper-emotionalization and disgust can escalate, and this hyper-emotionalization, the fact that the most emotional thing gets pulled to the front and those storms of indignation, disgust, outrage, they can escalate. And I looked at this, and I was using Twitter to observe this. A person that sees something's happening, a person one says, oh, and what is this about? Occasion X. Someone who's confused about some political event, some utterance, and the same hashtag then, if you're on Twitter, leads us to someone else who is much more emotional. Hatred, 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 go dying, you worm. Again, tagged with the same hashtag. So far, so normal. That there are people that voice a certain irritation and others voice a very strong irritation leading to outright hatred. But now you see that indignation from outside, and this is how it looks. You have person two at the top. Down below, you have person three who finds this all nonsensical, but person one, who felt quite harmless at first, suddenly, from an external point of view, combined with these others, the illusion has been created that person one was taking part in a storm of indignation as well. I've perceived this on myself too. You may not have known this, but I have been in the center of one of those storms of outrage. In 2009, for example, I was hugely offended when my appearance in an advertisement of mobile provider Vodafone had a strong effect on people that I considered friends, and they started hacking or attacking me. And these were people that I didn't expect to do this at all. And some people I immediately blogged about, but some of these simply had joined the hashtag, and I saw them as part of a huge storm and considered them participants from outside, while from an inside point of view, it wasn't like that at all, because the interior view is that person one says, oh, what is this about? And then someone as person four comes along and says, I know this guy. You, of all people, are taking part in this. Are you stupid? Aggression levels are rising, and person one now asks, how aggressive are you? And you see the social linking there and the inside versus the outside view leading to an acceleration. And all that engaged me so much that I couldn't avoid making a video with the Doclights company to be shown on ZDF Neo, a side channel of a public broadcaster in Germany. So this is where, what is TV? It's like being on YouTube, but someone else is selecting for you. A small extract.
Ich bin dafür nämlich auch
liar press, liar press, liar press. I went to a demonstration here where exactly these people that I had only been debating with were actually present. It looks a bit threatening at first sight, but actually there were police people around me. Traitor, someone's shouting. Now, this is what I'm telling you about today, but I'm going to tell this to the normal TV audience, and there will be a debating website about the movie. Manipulated is the English translation, so manipuliert.de. And this is where you have to take part. And this is the task I'm setting to you that will lead to me maybe overdrawing for 2 or 3 minutes, because the old dream, finally, that all of us who are interested in a liberal democracy, the internet people, we can all improve the world from the couch in our pajamas or not wearing trousers at all, which is optional, by the way.
Und zwar nach dem Motto,
and the motto is talk with the right wing against the right wing. So why exactly, you can ask? Can you actually talk to Nazis? But around that, as we've seen, there are many people that perhaps or perhaps not always aren't Nazis. And that I've been able to find out really is the case. But still, why should you talk? Just to talk, but just to find out whether they're Nazis or not, or just wading in that brown sauce? And this is what Megan Fels-Roper has something to say about, a woman that grew up in the Westboro Baptist Church and had these posters, banners, God hates fags. The grandchild of the founder, by the way, those were the people that went to gay soldiers' funerals to shout out there that they thought that gays deserve the death penalty, but not just gays, but Jews as well. Westboro Baptist Church has a very strong anti-Semitic streak, or they have a lot of anti-Semitism, strong anti-Semitism, because what I'm showing here is a talk from early this year by this Megan Phelps-Roper, who started to discuss on Twitter with people that did not believe that gays deserve the death penalty. And she got into closer communication with some of these people, and she grew up in this unbelievable hatred. But at some point, they both partners noticed, she and her communication partner began to perceive themselves as human beings, each other, and that changed the way they talked. And that so a doubt in her. And I think this doubt can be sown in our heads. We may just be 3,000, but you can carry this on. And out of these conversations, sow more and more doubt. And you can find out how exactly this happened. That's what I tried. How can someone from a hatred-filled opinion transition to one of these dirty, slightly wet opinions in that brown sauce? How can you shift them back onto the island? What I don't think is correct is this approach. I respect Dunja Hayali a lot. We have to talk, she says, but that doesn't mean, it doesn't mean talking with their functionaries and the heads of the parties. And there is a simple reason for that, and that is normalization. Normalization is a clear trap in this endeavor. To say at some point, we'll have to talk with everyone, even those that propagate hate, after asking three times and excluding that they're just temporarily angry, there is a very bad, very black, very dark joke of the American left about the debate in the US media, and this is how it goes. A Nazi yells, kill all Jews. A left one says, no. The presenter says, now these are the two extremes, and now we'll find balance, try to find a balanced medium position. Now, this trap of normalization is something you can fall into if you don't talk to the people themselves, but put yourself on a stage in a too symbolic way to kind of.
Und gleichzeitig ist das natürlich richtig, aber leider ist ich bin hier so gut es ist und ihr solltet alle Mitglied werden und mitdiskutieren.
As good as ich bin hier, I am here is, and you should all become a member, is not just an insignia of those that hold out against. It's also an invitation to ignore. The people that see this hashtag don't no longer see what's happening inside. So I think we need a new strategy. Surprise. We are many, and if you are many, you have the big advantage that you can reach a common goal without everyone having to do the same. And that means this Merkel Must Go demo rally that I went to and went to the right-wing rubble. There was a counter-demo, of course, as well. And next to the debate that you have to have, there must be the countering as well. It deserves all the love in the world. It's extremely necessary. And why? Because I think we need a pincer kind of approach. In on one side, a clear position and no debate, and on the other side, people that do extend a hand and try to discuss. So I'm not talking about calling for everyone to, you know, get into an understanding mode. We have to do both.
Verhalten Applaus.
There was a counter-argument from the audience, and
aber ich glaube
they
phrased so,
slight applause.
Die ich auch vertreten habe, nicht ganz so gut funktioniert hat.
I think the demarcation that I've tried myself didn't work that well, and because the pincer strategy is so important, I'll first look at the obstacles for debates before I look at the instruments. For one thing, there is the mistrust in media, which I consider an immunization against pluralism. The people that say liar press
are
basically giving themselves the freedom to conduct selective perception. So this is correct, so the censor was sleeping, and this is not correct. That kind of thinking. Selective perception, how that works, is has been shown by the Washington Post in late January, because they showed photos, these two photos, to people in the U.S., one of those from the Trump inauguration and the other from the Obama inauguration before that. 40% of the people that voted for Trump said photo B is of course the Trump photo, because there are so many people more there. I don't consider that much of a problem. If someone says, well, Trump surely had more people because Trump said that, that's how you might get to that opinion. The much more problematic thing is the 15% that said, yes, photo A is from the Trump inauguration, but there are more people on it than in photo B. People actually said that. And that, to me, is a sign that this mistrust in the media goes much deeper. The question people have tried to scientifically resolve this: why do Trump supporters believe so many things that are crazy and wrong? The interesting thing is that scientific research exists about this by a man called Dan Kahan, a professor from Yale, who has the Cultural Cognition Project, who runs it. And the interesting thing here is that these people share information from social media not because they're right, but because it makes them present themselves as a member of some group. They want to show, hi, I'm a good member of this group. And for this social function of news, it doesn't matter at all whether they're correct or not. The second obstacle, the big obstacle, is cognitive distortion, perception mistakes and social media. Perception mistakes that have an effect on us all, not just on right-wing and right-wing extremist people, but perception errors that down to the detail change our perception of the world. A short overview of the effects of just tagging along,
error of
attribution, the error of putting things into groups, and attributing a lot more effective activity to the membership of a group.
And framing effect,
most decisive for for recognition of things is the framing effect, the truth effect, the blind spot, Maslow's hammer, correlation of illusion, and it just goes on and on. Loads of psychological effects and fallacies that change our perception all the way down to virtuality. I think it's still dramatically underestimated how much the distance provided by a screen changes our perception, and how little of those midtones is carried through, even though we now have emoji. But What now? Now what? We see all these mechanisms that get in the way, and if it doesn't work like this, if you have to consider these things, then how does it work? I found 5 points that I want you to take home. The first of them is, unsurprisingly, the same thing you can see if you watch Ich bin hier. So the tone and mechanic, the way of arguing is crucial. You have to be polite and patient. You have to wait even though the general heat. You have to ask genuine questions, because once you do that, you give your opponent the opportunity to reposition themselves.
Echte Fragen sein.
They have to be genuine questions. You have to separate opinions from the people who have them. So you shouldn't say you're a Nazi. Instead, you should say that opinion seems to be the opinion of a Nazi. I'm exaggerating a little. And you have to show understanding for people's reasoning, and that's difficult.
Temporäres Arschloch, also das ist jetzt ein Beispiel, aber
just as an example, you might say, yeah, that's your opinion because you're a temporary asshole. And you also have to acknowledge your own weaknesses. And this leads me to the second point, that you can try to use in the strategy to drag people back onto this island.
It's Gedanken von ungefähr ab 1657
partial encouragement.
Blaise
Pascal said something that seems very obvious from to us today, but it was actually revolutionary in his time. And it's that if you say you're wrong, the people react defensively. If you instead say you're completely right in 9 out of 10 points, but in just this one where you say that everybody, we should murder everyone, then that might not be quite right. And you have to try to separate the good point from the bad by praising some things that are just tendentially right. Like it may seem weird to praise, to say, yeah, great spelling in your Holocaust denial, but
gut funktionierend.
If you acknowledge that there's simply a difference in the way you approach solutions, then that gets you quite far. The next point that I might also call the second point is facts and their discussion. In 1975, there was this interesting experiment that worked in a very simple way. Two groups of people were given suicide notes. So notes from people who were supposed to have committed suicide, and also faked suicide notes. And one group was told, wow, out of 24 notes, you classified all 24 correctly. You're a genius. And the other group was told, oh, sorry, you were dreadful. You didn't even classify 10 correctly. That's even worse than chance. And then the researchers told these people, this was all just made up. It's not right. Your solution was wrong. And simply in stating that, almost nothing changed. The people were still convinced that they were either very good at separating genuine from fake suicide notes. So simply stating this was not enough. What was enough instead was the discussion. When the researchers started engaging subjects in debate and not only, and also told them how they started faking these notes. And finally, as my fourth fact, encourage empathy and awaken doubts. And this works surprisingly well. The simple call to try to understand other people and to allow others to identify themselves was
da sind Menschen von Tür zu Tür gezogen und haben versucht,
encouraged scientifically last year in this piece of research on transphobia.
Und diesem nicht mal 10-minütigen oder im Durchschnitt 10-minütigen Gespräche,
they conducted
gesellschaftlich betrachtet
discourse that lasted for less than 10 minutes, but in only 10 minutes, these researchers brought about a decade of change. And in this direct exchange, people were encouraged to doubt their own positions. They were convinced to be less rejecting, and this lasted for months. And the fifth is a type of immunization. This is a paper I found on the subject of climate change, and we've seen an armada of misinformation on this subject. And the researchers wanted to find out how people can be vaccinated against this misinformation. It was conducted by Sander van der Linden, Anthony Lazarevitz, Seth Rosenthal and Edward Maybach, and their hypothesis was that immunizations
that
opinion vaccinations and health vaccinations against illnesses work in exactly the same way. So you don't only have to conduct debunking, but also pre-bunking by spreading weakened misinformation before the actual misinformation has time to spread. So apparently you can use fake news against even worse fake news by pointing out the mechanics of fake news on a weakened example. And
screenshot vom 18. April diesen Jahres,
I want to use this to show you the screenshot from 2014, where I spent a lot of time arguing with somebody from my circle of friends, somebody whose name I'm never ever going to disclose, and they wrote something that actually caused me to shed a tear. It really did. And this came in the midst of all my efforts, and it's not faked, because I spent so much time being annoyed. I think our argument has prevented me from tipping completely towards the right. It all stays complicated, but thank you. No, thank you, my friend, for having managed this.
Ich weiß nicht, ob wir
I don't know if we can actually change something. I have a suspicion that we might, if we simply go out and start arguing, engaging people in discussion. But I can't guarantee it. But if we have learned, if the past months and years have taught us something, then it's that there's a certain power of the word. It was obvious how some debates tipped towards the right with almost nothing but words.
We've seen,
and this is also the rise of the authoritarianism, that words have a power, and debates have a power, and if this is the only good thing that this rise of authoritarianism has brought with it, then it's the acknowledgement that words have power. So I call upon you to reverse this change, just simply to go out and engage people in discussion. If each of us only gets one of these bits of feedback, then this may be enough to make this island of liberal democracy that it fits most people. Thank you for listening.